وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. Brothers and sisters, viewers watching from around the world on Ahl al-Bayt TV, Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to our jam-packed program celebrating the wiladat of Qamar Bani Hashim Abul Fadhl al-Abbas alayhi salam, the father of virtues. Inshallah, you are sitting comfortably. We are going to have a long program, inshallah, not long-winded, but a program with lectures, poetry, and anashid. Imam al-Mahdi, ajjalallah ta'ala farajahu al-sharif, in his ziyarat to Abul Fadhl al-Abbas, says, "Peace be upon you, O Abbas, son of Amir al-Mu'mineen. You preferred your brother to yourself, supplied yourself with opportunities of today for reward of tomorrow, sacrificed yourself for your brother, protected him, hurried to fetch him water, and your two hands were cut. Abbas, surely you were the righteous servant of Allah." He was Al-Abbas, the son of Ali, the son of Abu Talib, the son of Abdul Muttalib, the son of Hashim. His mother was Ummul Banin, Fatima, the daughter of Hizam. Born on the 4th of Sha'ban, in the year 26 after Hijra, in the holy city of Medina, the whole world glittered. Inshallah, what I will try and do is firstly take a few glimpses at the life of Abul Fadhl al-Abbas alayhi salam, and secondly, let you know his nicknames and his names. The first name he is known by is Al-Abbas, the lion that other lions fear and escape. This name is called on the courageous and the fearless, the strong and the attacker. In his book Al-Turayhi, in the book Al-Muntakhab, says about Abbas ibn Ali, "Al-Abbas ibn Ali looked like an unshakable mountain. His heart was as the same as a mound because he was such a unique horseman and hero. And in battlefields, he was fearless." I would now firstly like to welcome my first guest. He has been in Al-Najaf Al-Ashraf for the last 2 years. I am delighted to add a little word to his name, Sayed Zafar Abbas Al-Najafi, who will speak about the knowledge and bravery of Abbas ibn Ali, inheritor of his father. We welcome him with a loud salawat.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام والتحية والإكرام على النبي الأمي العربي القرشي المكي المدني الهاشمي صاحب قاب قوسين محبوب رب المشرقين والمغربين جد الحسن والحسين النبي الحرمين والإمام القبلتين والرسول الثقلين الذين سمي في السماء بأحمد وفي الأرض بأبي القاسم محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين ولعنة الدائمة الباقية على أعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم وغاصب حقوقهم أجمعين أما بعد فقد قال إمام علي بن الحسين عليه الصلاة والسلام Inna lil-Abbas maqaman yughbituhu jami' ash-shuhada. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. When we discussed the life of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam a couple of weeks ago, we mentioned that the most amazing thing about his life, about his personality, about his person, is that he has all of these qualities which is virtually impossible to find in one person. They are qualities which, if somebody possesses one of them, it's very unlikely, indeed, almost impossible for him to possess the other. Yet we saw that all of these characteristics, all of these qualities were found within his person. And of course, we might say that because he's an imam, because he's the successor of the Holy Prophet, because he's been entrusted with guiding the nation, it is necessary for him to possess these characteristics. But when we come and we look at the life of Abul Fadhl Abbas alayhi salam, we see that he too possesses some of these characteristics which appear at first sight to be antithetical to one another. And here we can't say that he is the leader of the people, he's an imam. No, he isn't an imam. Yet he possesses these two characteristics. We talk much about the bravery of Abul Fadhl Abbas. We mention his courage. We say how wonderfully brave he was. We talk about the fact that every single member of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam had confidence in him. They were satisfied wherever he was. Everyone was at peace. They knew that nobody could do anything to harm them if Abul Fadhl Abbas was around. But the characteristic of his that we don't talk about so much is his knowledge. And it is seen in our society amongst people that these two characteristics are antithetical of one another. That we find that most people who are scholars are not amazing in the battlefield. They're not warriors, they're not courageous individuals in the sense of being able to fight battles. And we also see, on the other side, that a person who is a courageous warrior, is amazing in the battlefield, is more often than not a scholar, not a knowledgeable person, not somebody who possesses much knowledge. Rather, to the contrary, most of those people are not very knowledgeable at all. Yet, just a cursory look at Abul Fadhl Abbas's life tells us that both his knowledge and his bravery were undoubtedly the inheritance of his father Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam. There is a story mentioned by this scholar himself who says that one day I was talking about Abul Fadhl Abbas and I said that while we know about his courage and his bravery, his amazing feats in the battlefield, inshallah, which we'll come to in a moment, we don't know about his knowledge. We don't know whether he was a knowledgeable person or not. The scholar himself narrates that after I had mentioned this and I went to sleep, Abul Fadhl Abbas came to me in the dream. And he asked me a question. I didn't have the answer to that question. I said to him, "This is a very difficult question." Abul Fadhl Abbas says to me, the scholar says, he said to me, "You learnt the knowledge of my father from books. You learnt the knowledge of my father from books, and you fancied yourself as a scholar. You consider yourself as a scholar. Did you not pause to think that the one who got knowledge from Amirul Mu'mineen directly, the one who did not need books in order to get knowledge from Amirul Mu'mineen, the one who was there getting knowledge directly from Amirul Mu'mineen, did you not think that he would be knowledgeable as well?" The scholar wakes up and the next day he goes to the lesson that he's teaching and he says, "I'd like to take back what I said yesterday. There's no doubt about the knowledge of Abul Fadhl Abbas alayhi salatu wasalam, that he, in addition to his bravery, in addition to his amazing feats in the battlefield, was most certainly a scholar." Was most certainly a scholar. And that, how could he not be? Even those individuals who spent time with Amirul Mu'mineen, who came and were for a few years stayed in the company of Amirul Mu'mineen, became scholars. Abdullah ibn Abbas, cousin of the Holy Prophet and Amirul Mu'mineen, spent some time with Amirul Mu'mineen, and he's known as the Mufassir of Holy Quran, as a interpreter of the Holy Quran. He learned this from Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam, that they discussed the meaning of Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In one night, it took them from the time of Isha to the time of Fajr discussing Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And at the end of the night, just before the Fajr prayer, Amir al-Mu'mineen told him, the summary is this, that all of the knowledge is in the Quran, and all of the Quran is in Surah Al-Fatiha, and all of Fatiha is in Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And all of Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is in the Ba, and the dot underneath the Ba is me. He who spent some time with Amir al-Mu'mineen became a scholar, known as a scholar of Hadith, of scholar of the religion of Islam, an authority on what the Holy Prophet said. Yet the one who was born in the house of Amir al-Mu'mineen, the one who spent all of his waking moments with Amir al-Mu'mineen, how could we even come close to accounting for how much knowledge he has? And if that was not enough, Sadiq Ali Muhammad Imam Jafar Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam says, there's a narration from the Holy Prophet that Sha'ban is my month, and the greatest act of worship in this month is the recitation of salawat. So can we have a proper one, please? The Imam says, my uncle Abbas, sufficient for his greatness is that my uncle Abbas was a man of firm faith and clear insight. Nafidhul Basira. You can't have clear insight if you're not knowledgeable. There's no insight without knowledge. The Imam alayhi salatu wasalam says he has clear insight because he's so knowledgeable, because he's so capable. The fact that his, even stories about his life, the first thing that anybody, when they want to research about Abul Fadhl Abbas, will find is the lack of resources about his life. But perhaps it's an indication, it's a reflection of his whole life, that his whole life was spent in the shadow of not his brother, but his master Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. That he didn't allow anybody to realize the fact that he, in his own right, was such a great scholar. That he spent his whole life in the shadow of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. Such was his humility. Such was his reverence for Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. Just the simple statement from his mother that remember that Hussein is the son of Fatima al-Zahra. And you are my son. That Hussein is the son of Fatima al-Zahra. Peace and blessings be upon her. And you are my son. And that is the difference between you and him. Just as the difference between Fatima al-Zahra and me, that she is the greatest lady to have been created. So Abul Fadhl Abbas alayhi salam makes this his goal in life, to make sure that he lives in the shadow of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. Just as Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam had lived in the shadow of the Holy Prophet. In exactly the same way. Because the narration that says that Amir al-Mu'mineen says that I took the knowledge from the Holy Prophet like a bird, like a baby takes the, like a baby bird takes the food from its mother through the beak. That is how I took the knowledge from the Holy Prophet. And there's a narration from another infallible which says that Abul Fadhl Abbas, this is how he took the knowledge from Imam Hussein alayhi salam. That he never let anybody find out is down to his humility and his greatness and his reverence for Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, that nobody was able to realize the extent of his knowledge. But undoubted was his knowledge. Undoubted was his insight from a young age. There's a narration which is attributed to various individuals in the house of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, but it's most famously attributed to Abul Fadhl Abbas. When Abul Fadhl Abbas is very young, maybe 5 or 6 years old, and Amir al-Mu'mineen is teaching him the numbers, and he says, say one. So Abul Fadhl Abbas says one. Now Amir al-Mu'mineen says, now say two. So he's silent. He doesn't say anything. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, say two. He still doesn't say anything. So Amir al-Mu'mineen asks him, he says, why don't you say two? And Abul Fadhl Abbas says, oh my father, how can the tongue which has professed one say two? How can the tongue which has professed in the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by saying one, how can it say two? This is Abul Fadhl Abbas, not an imam, not a prophet. This is Abul Fadhl Abbas, 5 years old. That's why Imam al-Sadiq says, Ammi Abbas, Nafidhul Basira. Clear insight. This is him at 5 years old, when he's grown up. Imagine, we can imagine, you can't even get close to imagining how much knowledge he has. That he says, how can the tongue which has professed the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say two? And his devotion, his love for Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam is to the extent that he's young. One occasion Imam Hussein alayhi salam asks for water. He comes back with the water, he notices that Imam Hussein has gone to sleep. He stands there the whole night with the water, until he wakes up in the morning. He's showing his devotion. He's saying, even for the water, even for this water, he could have left it and gone back to do his own thing. No, he's standing there. He said, he told me to get water. Now he's gone to sleep. Until he wakes up, he's standing there the whole night, until the morning, when he wakes up, and then he presents the water to Imam Hussein. But this is Abul Fadhl Abbas showing his devotion. He's showing his grandeur. He's showing why he's so important. Why are we celebrating his life? Why are we celebrating his life? That every single son of Amir al-Mu'mineen has a special place. But Abul Fadhl Abbas, he's the one person, the only person, Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein, alayhi salam, they're imams, and no doubt their status is great. But there's only one person for whom Amirul Mu'mineen prays and says, I want a son who will come to the aid of my son Hussein in Karbala. There's only one son that Amirul Mu'mineen prays for. And they say that great people have great expectations. They receive greatness. Zakariya prayed and he received Yahya. Amir al-Mu'mineen prayed and he received Abul Fadhl Abbas. That when he's born, not only is Imam Hussein alayhi salam so devoted to him, but Sayyidah Zainab salamullah alayha is also so devoted. That she asks her father, she says, Ya, oh my father, have you decided on a name for my brother? And Amir al-Mu'mineen says, indeed I have, I've named him Abbas. As you heard in the dictionaries of the Arabic language, Abbas, amongst its many meanings, one of them is the lion, which other lions are fearful of. The lion is an animal which is not fearful of many things. Indeed, everything else is fearful of the lion. But Abbas is the lion of which other lions are fearful of. That's Abbas. That every warrior, when he hears that Abbas is there, anybody who wants to say anything is unable in the presence of Abul Fadhl Abbas. That every single woman of the household of the Holy Prophet is at peace. Nobody can do anything to us Because Abbas is there. Because Abbas is there. But how do we know? When we come into the battle of Karbala, we know lots about Abul Fadhl Abbas and his role in Karbala. But how does everybody know? The question is, how does everybody know that Abul Fadhl Abbas is so brave? Surely he's only in his 30s, and there's no examples prior to this of where he would have displayed this bravery. So how does everyone know? So the only answer is that there must have been an occasion prior to the Battle of Karbala where Abul Fadhl Abbas displayed such bravery, such amazingness, that everyone's fearful of him. So we find, yes, there is an occasion. And the reason I've said this first is because if I mention this story, somebody might say, this doesn't sound very believable. This sounds out of something out of a film. Is this really real? Well, this is the proof that it's real. That everybody is so fearful of him. They know what he's capable of. Abul Fadhl Abbas is born in the 26th year after Hijrah. The Battle of Siffin takes place in the 37th year after Hijrah. It is the second battle during the reign of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. The Battle of Basra, better known as the Battle of Jamal, is the first one. And on its completion, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam moves from Basra to the Syrian-Iraqi border, which is where the Battle of Siffin takes place. So in the 37th year of Hijrah, Abul Fadhl Abbas is how old? 11. He's 11 years old. And aged 11 in the Battle of Siffin, Abul Fadhl Abbas is present. Okay, so he's present. What did he do in the Battle of Siffin that makes him such a fearful candidate, a fearful opponent? So he's 11 years old, and Amir al-Mu'mineen knows that if an 11-year-old child is sent into the battlefield, then there's no way anybody is going to come out and fight him. As far as Arab cultural norms are concerned, it is very odd for somebody to come and fight a child. Indeed, a child would not be part of the battle. And it would be considered a great insult to someone who was much older to come and fight even a young man, let alone a child. So Amir al-Mu'mineen prepares him in his own armor to go into the battlefield. And his face is covered, so nobody can see who it is that is entering into the battlefield. And when he enters into this battlefield, and he strikes, the report says that he entered into the battlefield and he striked as if a bolt of lightning had hit the forces of the ruler of Damascus. They were all confused, looking at one another as if to ask, where did that come from? What was that? Did we miss something? And so, now even the people on the side of Amir al-Mu'mineen don't know, because the face is covered. Nobody can see who it is. There's a warrior from the side of the Amir of Sham. And he, Amr ibn As says to him, go and fight this bolt of lightning, wherever it's come from. So he says the same thing. He says, as far as the Arab cultural norms are concerned, it's inconceivable that someone like me could go and fight someone who looks, apparently, we don't know who he is, we don't know how old he is, but he looks very young. This warrior, known as Ibn Sha'sha, sends out one of his sons into the battlefield. So the son fights, and he is killed. Then he sends in another one of his sons. He has seven sons. All seven of them are killed. Now, he's really surprised. He doesn't know who this person is. And he's just killed seven of his sons who are known as amazing warriors in Damascus. So he himself comes into the battlefield and he is killed as well. Now, you can imagine what they're thinking. What's going on? Who is this person? Who has come out into the battlefield? We've been fighting for so long, and we've seen nothing like this. So somebody says, this style of fighting, this method of fighting, is the method of Amir al-Mu'mineen. So it must be him. Well, now we know Amir al-Mu'mineen has not yet come out into the battlefield. Other people have been fighting. So they all begin to say, this must be Amir al-Mu'mineen, who has come out into the battlefield. Yet they're also thinking, this person looks far too young to be Amir al-Mu'mineen. Remember, this was in Badr and Uhud, where Amir al-Mu'mineen was a young man. By the time he's in the Battle of Siffin, Amir al-Mu'mineen is in his 50s. No doubt an imam is the same warrior whether he's 20 or he's 50. But there's still a noticeable difference in terms of physical characteristics. So they're all very confused. They say, this is the style of Amir al-Mu'mineen. This is the way of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Yet it can't be Amir al-Mu'mineen because he looks so young. At this moment, Amir al-Mu'mineen takes off the armor. So now they see, who is this? This is 11 years old, Abul Fadhl Abbas, who has just demonstrated annihilating seven of the most greatest warriors of Damascus. That yes, this is the new prodigy. He's here. And he has struck fear deep into the hearts of any enemy of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Do they know that Amir al-Mu'mineen might die, but he's just replaced him with somebody who's exactly like him in the battlefield, who doesn't have to lift a sword in Karbala. Just his name is sufficient. He's the only person in the Battle of Karbala who doesn't fight. Everybody else, all the other males, even 10 years old, Aun and Muhammad, 13 years old, Qasim, they're all fighting. Abul Fadhl Abbas is the only person who doesn't fight. Yet that's a testament to his reputation which he's maintained. That he doesn't have to fight. His name and his presence strikes fear in the heart of the enemy. The fact that it doesn't matter how many people are killed, if Abul Fadhl Abbas is there, the battle is not over. Abul Fadhl Abbas is there, just merely his name and his reputation is enough to strike fear in the hearts of the enemy. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this holy and blessed occasion of the births of all the heroes of Karbala, for the sake of their births, for the sake of their lives, for the sake of their honor, that he forgives our sins and the sins of our marhumin. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to alleviate our sufferings and especially the sufferings of all the followers of Ahlul Bayt all around the world, especially in Syria, in Iraq, in Pakistan, in Bahrain, wherever in the world followers of Ahlul Bayt are under oppression. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect their lives, their honor, their dignity, their wealth, their families. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to hasten the reappearance of the Imam of our time and to make us good enough to be amongst those who serve in his army. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما